of a true pastor. In this parable of the lost sheep in the 15th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel, starting at verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him.
Yes.
And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost."
My God.
Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. I want to have a companion scripture, Jeremiah 3:15, "And I will give you pastors after my own heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding." May the Lord add the blessing to the hearing, reading, and doing of his word.
Amen.
Pastoring with a shepherd's heart, I tweaked the title to "The True Character of a Good Pastor."
Yes, amen.
Why is this important? You need to know who you're following.
Yeah.
You need to know who's leading you, whether or not they're the right person for you, whether God placed them there, whether they have the characteristics of the shepherd that Jesus Christ himself portrays. In this parable is not so much about the shepherd. It's answering a question. There are some people that says that Jesus has come, and why are all the sinners and the publicans, the tax collectors, they're all wanting to hear what he has to say? Too often we're more concerned with being church people than people that reach the world. So often we're too concerned with being church people than people who reach the world. The world is in need. Religious people sit in a very high position. They look down their nose. They say you're not good enough.
Yeah.
And when they come in, you put them in the back pew. You don't like the way the world smells and the world looks, but the world is looking for help. But we can be so caught up in religiosity that we forget that's who we were at one time.
Go ahead. Amen.
So Jesus is answering a question to these people. He heard their grumbling and their murmuring.
Yes.
And they were talking about, why is these people, why do he associate with the world? Why does he associate with sinners? Why do they want to hear him so often? You know, they called him all kinds of names. They called him the devil, the son of the devil. They called him a blasphemer. All because he was reaching those that needed help.
Yeah.
Religious people think they don't need him. And so often in our churches, we act like we are the ones that are high and mighty and high and lifted up. But there's only one that's high and lifted up, and that is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So he tells them this parable. A parable is a story with a spiritual meaning. He wanted to get something across to him, and he talks about a man who is a shepherd who has lost a sheep. You know, so often I remember reading, that when you see all the pictures of the little lost sheep, there's a little baby sheep, so cute. Little baby sheep. And they got Jesus, and he walking with the little sheep. And your heart goes out to that little sheep because it's a little baby sheep. I don't see that in this story.
Go ahead.
I don't see a little baby sheep in this story. He said a sheep that was lost. He didn't say how old it was, how small it was, how big it was, and what it looked like. He said it was lost. It was a sheep. And in the story, he talks about that this, he says he had 100 of them. He had a flock. That was his church. He had 100 sheep.
Yeah.
In the scriptures, God has always used the lowly picture of a shepherd to depict how Jesus Christ lives and works with us. And then he goes a little further in depicting the shepherd by saying that I'm going to give you shepherds.
Go ahead.
Have you noticed that a shepherd is not a lofty position? He says, I'm not going to give you a king.
Yeah.
I'm not going to give you a dictator. I'm not giving you somebody high and lifted up that looks good and walks tall and has all the best words. He said, I'm going to give you a shepherd. He didn't say, I'm going to give you somebody with great speaking ability and great charisma that you're attracted to. He said, I'm going to give you a shepherd. And he's going to have a specific heart. That means he's going to have certain character.
Yeah.
As a church, you need to evaluate who's standing in your pulpit. Mm-hmm.
That's it.
And if you have a good shepherd, you ought to thank God every day that you have a good shepherd. Because there are people right now that are starving for a shepherd.
That's true.
Churches are being divided as they go through the search for a shepherd. They're looking for somebody. All of us want somebody that we can follow.
Yeah.
And then there's those that are now trying to pastor 2 and 3 churches distance wide.
Yeah.
There's a church pastor over here that also going to pastor in Detroit.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that's a good shepherd.
Uh-huh.
Because the shepherd has to have a relationship with the sheep.
Right.
If you look at what he's saying there, he says the Greek word for pastor is pomein, which is translated shepherd.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Pastor is the same word as shepherd. There's no difference in that.
Yeah.
And the Hebrew word is rehah, which means shepherd or to be a shepherd. It's amazing that God has taken a profession that is not in and of itself a lofty position. Yet this pomein, shepherd, pastor, is elevated by God himself to be in a high position with great responsibility. A true shepherd is responsible for the sheep.
Yes.
You can't have a shepherd unless you have sheep.
That's right.
And sheep need a shepherd. The nature of sheep is that they wander all over the place. They don't have good eyesight. Mm-hmm. They can't protect themselves. Sheep are some of the most defenseless animals on the planet.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
They don't have no teeth to fight anything off. They got no horn cut off their nose. They got no long trunk.
Yeah.
They got no claws like a lion. They don't have nothing that allows them to protect themselves.
Yeah.
So they need a shepherd. They need a protector.
Yeah.
Then they have a hard time finding food to eat, so they need somebody to lead them to where food is.
Man.
They have a tendency to get lost because their eyesight is not straight ahead, it's all to the side.
Uh-huh.
And they can wander off. But the nature of sheep is that they're gregarious animals. They are built for society.
Yeah.
Why do you think God used the sheep as an example for his flock? Mm-hmm. Because all we like sheep have gone astray.
Amen.
And we have turned everyone to his own way. So he talks about us that we are just like sheep.
Yeah.
We can't protect ourselves from the devil.
Yeah.
We can't find our own food. We are gregarious people. That means we are society. We are in relationship with one another.
Yeah.
The church is built on relationships.
Yeah.
The shepherd must have a relationship with the sheep.
Go ahead.
If the shepherd can't have a relationship with the sheep, then he's not a good shepherd. What does it mean to have a relationship with the sheep? He knows them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sheep have many other characteristics. All of sheep are not nice and polite sheep. We got some mean sheep in the church.
Amen.
There's some mean sheep. Boy, they just look, they look at you all crazy, their eyes go all crossed. We got some mean sheep in the church.
Yeah.
The pastor still must pastor the mean sheep.
Amen.
Then we got angry sheep. We got jealous sheep. I want to be up front with the other sheep. Their fur is better than mine. They got a bigger hat. I should be up there. They're pretty sheep. I'm a fine sheep. Notice me. We got all kinds of sheep in the flock. Then we have those hard-headed sheep, the male sheep that have horns, and they always butt heads with somebody.
Go ahead.
We have all kinds of sheep in the congregation in that flock. The flock is not just a nice little group of people that sit around and they sing Kumbaya. They're not always saying Amazing Grace. They're not always saying that God is smiling on me. They're also saying, look at me. Why are you not noticing me? We got fat sheep, skinny sheep, big sheep, small sheep.
Yeah.
Sheep comes in all shapes and sizes.
Man.
We got baby sheep.
Yeah.
In that flock, there's any number of sheep that the pastor or the shepherd has to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
It's important that he knows his sheep.
Yeah.
If he doesn't know his sheep, then he is just not being a good shepherd.
Yeah.
The second thing in a relationship of knowing the sheep know the pastor.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice and they know me. Sheep, if you look it up, understand they recognize their shepherd.
Yeah.
After years of working with them, they recognize a stranger can come up, they're going to run off.
Uh-huh.
But they can see a form of their shepherd, and they can recognize him through a smell. The sheep know their shepherd. And they know his voice. If another voice comes, they're going to separate. But they hear the voice of their shepherd. They know them, and they have confidence. See, with a relationship with your pastor, and a pastor relationship with his flock, you can have confidence that you're going in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
It's important that you do have a shepherd, because we are sheep. We are in concert with one another, and we have a destination that we need to get to. In those days, the shepherd had to make sure that the sheep had food to eat.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sheep are not hunters. Mm-hmm. A lion will get his own food. Mm-hmm. A tiger will, even a coyote will sneak around and get something. Mm-hmm. A fox will go in the hen house and get some eggs. Weasels, all these bad personality animals, they do things. But a sheep cannot get its own food. It can only eat what's in front of it. Mm-hmm. Right. And when that's all gone, it needs somebody to lead him somewhere else.
Yeah.
It's important to have a shepherd, a good shepherd.
My God.
So anyway, as the sheep needs food, the shepherd must find food for the sheep.
Go ahead.
So he says that he has to lead the sheep. Mm-hmm. So in order to lead the sheep must have confidence in the shepherd. Yeah. Because you're believing that he's going to get you fed.
Yeah.
Not only do the sheep need food, it needs water.
Yes.
And even when there's a dry place, he got to bring them and find water.
Yes.
So the sheep are relying upon the shepherd for food and water in order to maintain. The sheep, in the summertime, you understand why they cut sheep's wool is because the sheep get too hot. Mm-hmm. Sheep don't shed wool.
Yes.
We thought it was just for money. And it is sometimes. But it's also because the sheep has to be maintained.
Yes.
And so they shear the sheep, and obviously they sell the wool. But a real shepherd is not so much concerned with making commerce of you. He's not concerned with making money off of you as much as protecting you and caring for you. Mm-hmm. That's what a real shepherd does. Mm-hmm. A false shepherd is trying to get everything you have. Yes. They see you as a commodity. Mm-hmm. They see you as somebody that can contribute to their well-being. They're not concerned about contributing to your well-being.
Uh-huh.
A real shepherd is concerned about the well-being of his sheep.
Yeah.
The sheep are more than sheep becomes his family.
Yes.
He's out there alone with the sheep. If you remember the story of David before he got anointed king, Saul had left his lofty position because he was disobedient to God.
Yeah, that's right.
So he sent him, Samuel, to Jesse. Yeah. And he says, in this family, there's a new king that I'm going to anoint. Mm-hmm. And he brought all of the sons before him. They were all big and strong. They looked good. Samuel said, it must be this one. Boy, he sure looked good.
Yeah.
All right.
And you look at this one, he's nice. He's attractive to look at. But God said it was not any one of them.
Yeah.
Because God. I'm not looking on the outside of the person. Yeah. I'm looking at what they have inside and whether they can be loyal to me.
Go ahead.
So all of a sudden he said, I have one more son. And he brings and he said, that's the one.
Mm-hmm.
He was little of stature. He was young, inexperienced.
Yeah.
But God saw something in David.
Yeah.
And he becomes known as a shepherd king.
Yeah.
But David is a picture of a shepherd because David says when he goes to meet Goliath, he had confidence to face conflict because of his experience as a shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
He had to fight a lion off.
Yeah.
And he had to fight a bear off. And why did he fight them off? Because he was protecting the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
There are lions and bears and tigers and all kinds of predators outside of this flock.
Yeah.
That wants to feed on you. They want to cut you out.
Yeah.
They want to defy you from the flock
so
that they can prey upon you.
Mm-hmm.
Not pray for you.
Mm-hmm.
Prey upon you. You become their food.
Yeah.
So you gotta understand, the shepherd is concerned with your well-being and your protection.
Yeah.
My God.
David talks about that. Some water here.
I'm good. I got you.
I'm water.
Mm-hmm.
See, he's a shepherd. I'm a thirsty sheep right now. Thank you. So as we see, David pictures this shepherd. He's a picture of a shepherd because he's concerned about his sheep.
Yeah.
And when he goes, he said, I protected the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you need in a shepherd.
Yeah.
Remember, pastor and shepherd is the same word.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So in this parable, he gives a picture of what a real shepherd is. In the parable, he's talking about how God rejoices over the lost sheep. But in here, you see something. He's counting his sheep.
Yes.
He has led them all day long. Now they're coming back to the fold.
Yeah, go ahead.
And what the shepherd would do, he would stand over there and make sure that he had counted for
every one of them.
Yeah. He knew how many sheep that he had.
Uh-huh.
He knew which ones had been newly born, and he counts them. Because what the shepherd would do at night, once they get into the fold, he would lay across the gate so that nothing could get in and nothing could get out.
Yeah.
So So he wanted to make sure they all were there, but all of a sudden he misses one sheep. If you want to understand the true character of a shepherd is that he is sacrificial. Because he leaves the comfort of his home. He leaves the comfort of that sheep. And he didn't say, well, I still got 99 of them. There's one missing. And he's concerned. You know why? Because that sheep is out there all alone and can't fend for himself. So he goes looking for them. And in those days, if he had to look for them, it was dangerous for him to even go out there.
Right.
I remember one time when I was chaplain at Juvenile Hall and we ran outside programs. There was this young woman, young girl, 16 years old. I found out from one of my volunteers, an Asian brother that lived in San Francisco, that she was out there in a tenderloin with a pimp.
My God.
And that was so concerning to him, and it was concerning to me.
Yeah.
Now, you know, if you go out in a tenderloin, you better be ready to handle some business. It's not a safe place in a tenderloin.
Yeah.
Tenderloin is where everything goes on. That's where they go to do their business. There's drugs going out there. There's guns out there. There's knives out there. And there's very angry people that have the personality and nature of lions and tigers. There's predators out there.
Yes. Yeah.
So he says, name was Ben. He said, Reverend Prince, we need to go out there and talk to Monica.
My God.
I said, okay. I'm from East Palo Alto. I ain't scared. All the time, my knees are not. But I know it could be conflict. I don't know what I'm going to face out there. So we go out to the tenderloin. Wow. And then we find her after a little while. We park and we wait. And here she comes with her pen.
My God.
And I said, Monica, hey, Reverend Press, how you doing? I said, we need to talk. The pen comes up. She, you're going to call us to talk to her. I said, I'm paying you nothing, man. Mm-hmm. I'm paying you a dime. I'm going to talk to her, and she's going to have a choice. You need to come, you need to turn yourself in and get yourself cleaned up. And she starts crying. He's still barking. I just give him the old East Palo Alto look. Let him know ain't nothing happening here. And she didn't make the decision then, but a week later, that decision changed her life. Here she comes in, I see her at Juvenile Hall, and Reverend Prince, nobody ever did anything like that for me. And my pimp said, I ain't messing with him. You need to go turn yourself in.
Wow.
And she turned herself in and went to a program.
Yeah.
And I haven't seen her since, but a shepherd will go out in dangerous places.
Yeah.
And in this pericope, you see the shepherd going out looking for the sheep in the dangerous places that he's going to.
Lord.
He's going into the highways and the hedges. He's going into crevices. And it's nighttime. Ain't no street lights in the desert.
Go ahead.
Ain't no street lights out there. He don't have a light, but he's going to all the places that he's been because he's concerned about the sheep. Why is he concerned about the sheep?
Come on now.
The sheep could be having a broken leg.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
The sheep could be being attacked by one of the wolves that are out there. The sheep could be bogged down in the mud and can't get out. That sheep is looking and crying and bleeding, hoping that somebody come, because in the darkness that sheep is scared.
That's it. That's
my
it.
God.
So here comes the shepherd looking for the sheep. The character of a shepherd is that he cares for the sheep.
Yes.
And when he cares for the sheep, he does something that's proved that he cares for the sheep. Because now he goes.
Yes.
He leaves the comfort of his wife and his daughters and his family to go to your bedside. That's the character of a shepherd.
Yes.
He leaves the comfort and the warmth of his home to look in on you. And when you're laying on your sick bed, he's there. And he's there when you're celebrating the birth of your child.
Amen.
He's celebrating birthdays and he's celebrating deaths. He's celebrating the whole faculties of life.
Yeah.
A shepherd is there through everything you go through, the good and the bad.
Yeah.
He's sacrificial.
Go ahead.
Because he must sacrifice, not only sacrifice his time, he also must sacrifice his means. And a lot of time, he is not even paid for what it is he's doing. Those that are demanding to get paid, I'm not saying you shouldn't support your pastor, you ought to. Those that labor the word is worthy of a double honor. But that's not why he does. It's not a job. Being a pastor is not a job. It's not something that you should apply for and go through and cite all your credentials. The true characteristic of a pastor is what's in his heart and how his heart is turned towards people.
Yes.
That's the character of a true pastor. You have to evaluate what you have here today. Do you have a true pastor or do you have a hireling? A hireling is somebody you hire, say, look, watch my sheep. But when danger comes, they say, I ain't going out there.
Yeah.
I kept 99 of them for you. That other one, you got to count that as a loss. But a true shepherd says, no, I'm not counting them as a loss. I'm going to look for my sheep because they're valuable to me, not for commerce, But they're valuable because I love them. I have a concern for them. My heart goes out to them. And he goes out into the highways and byways, and he goes into the mud. He walks through the darkness. He walks in dirty places.
Amen.
And he finds the sheep maybe bogged down in some mud, so he has to walk in the mud to pull the sheep out.
My God.
The true character of a pastor.
Amen.
This is what we're dealing with here. Inherent in this story, Jesus telling you what a real pastor does for his sheep.
Yes.
Then he, when he finds the sheep, after going through all that, you notice he didn't say how long it took him. Uh-huh. He didn't say he only looked for him for an hour.
Right.
He didn't say he looked for him too. It could have been days.
Yeah.
But he was searching diligently for, that shows you the value of you.
Right.
If your pastor doesn't value you that way, then he ain't a true pastor. Mm-hmm. If he can't value you wherever you are, if he finds you the money, he goes out there and tries to lift you up.
Yeah.
If you walked away, he's still saying, hey, there's room. Come on back.
Yeah.
And he noticed when he finds the sheep, he didn't say, you dumb sheep.
Yeah.
You stupid sheep. Why did you do what you did, you crazy sheep?
Yeah.
You made me walk out here all during the night. I walked out here and I got on. Look at my shoes. You got my shoes all muddy. I should have left you here to die. You don't hear that in this story. What you hear and what you see is the compassion of the shepherd for the sheep.
Yes.
Because he picks them up.
Right.
He may have a broken, the sheep may have a broken leg. And they might be weak from hunger. They may be dehydrated. But they can't move. They're lost out there. So what does he do?
Pick them up.
Despite how good his clothes look, he picks that sheep up. Now you notice, they may tell the story of a little lost lamb because it's easy to pick up a little lamb.
Yeah.
But this might be a fat sheep.
Yeah. You know?
Fat emotionally, emotional issues.
Yeah.
Loaded down.
Yeah.
Bloated with emotional issues. Bloated with mental health issues.
Yeah.
Bloated with cares of this world. That sheep is heavy.
Yeah.
It's heavy to carry people's load. I don't know if you understand that.
Mm-hmm.
If you're really a true pastor, you feel what your people feel.
Yeah.
You feel the emotional weight. And while you're encouraging them, you go home and cry and on your knees all hours of the night because you care about them.
Yeah.
So he picks the sheep up. Not only did he pick them up, he put them on his shoulders.
That's it.
And he retraces his steps.
Yes.
10 miles, 20 miles, whatever it was, carrying that sheep. A pastor helped you carry your burden.
My God.
Amen. He carries the load for you. And when you can't carry yourself, he's carrying you.
Man. Yeah.
That's what he does. I have artificial knees. I'm still trying to carry things. Because that's what we do.
Yeah.
He calls us to care for his sheep. I'm so concerned in this country today. I look at people that are trying to build big monuments to themselves.
Yes.
Bigger churches. Everybody want to be mega.
Yes.
And he's calling for you to be real.
Yes.
Everybody want to be big. Mm-hmm. Everybody want to be called bishop. Bishop just simply means shepherd.
Yes.
So you might as well call him bishop. Don't call him bishop. Mm-hmm. But it means shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean anything special.
Mm-hmm.
Was at a funeral the other day, and a friend of mine spoke to this guy and said, how you doing, pastor? He said, call me bishop. Well, wait a minute.
Yeah.
There's no higher title God can give
right.
you than shepherd
right.
because he says, I am the good shepherd.
Right.
If he's a shepherd, that's good enough for me. Call me shepherd.
Yeah.
If Jesus Christ has called me and commissioned me to be under him, to lead his people, I'm just a shepherd. I'm not even a shepherd. I'm the under shepherd. Because I answer to another shepherd.
Yeah.
I'm part of his family. He put me in charge to take care of what his is.
Yeah.
I have stewardship.
Yes.
So he carries the sheep back. And when he gets back, here's the other part that the shepherd shows. He shows joy.
Yeah.
I am so happy that I found my sheep. He called all his family together.
Yeah.
He called everyone together and says, look, I found my sheep. Now I have my whole group back together again.
Yeah.
That mother that lost that little sheep was glad to receive it.
Mm-hmm.
All the sheep, they're now in a safe place. And he said, let's have a party.
Yeah.
We're going to rejoice because that one that was lost is found.
Yeah.
Why was he found? Because a shepherd was looking for him.
Yeah.
The shepherd is critical. He is entrusted with the sheep, and the sheep need to follow his lead. You know, if you don't follow the lead of your pastor, then you're going to get lost.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know where you're going. He had to break the bread of life to you in order to get you where you need to go. I know this ain't a shouting sermon, but you ought to shout anyway because you got a pastor.
Go ahead.
Amen. I'm not going to kick my leg up and grab my ear and get you to shout. I'm going to give you the word of God because you need to understand that there are people today that are looking for a shepherd. Sometimes they even know what they're looking for. They're voting and they're doing things and they're looking at all this and that. Somebody said if Paul came back, he couldn't even get a church. Because if you look at him, Paul couldn't speak well. He stuttered. With a little cross-eyed, that's true. They said your letters are weighty, but you're weak in speech. And he wrote most of the New Testament.
Yeah.
He warned in Acts 20:28. He warned them. Be careful, pastor, to pay attention to yourself. First of all, he must look after himself. He must make sure his health and his spiritual health, his emotional health, his mental health is right. Because he has to lead you. So he says, be careful. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock. Not just the ones you like. Because there are some people that are very hard to like in every church. I mean, I've dealt with some that come at you in all kinds of ways. And you still must love them. And when they need you, you must be there. It's not dependent on who all support you. Whether they support you or not, you still must love them. That's a true pastor.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be careful of yourself. Pay attention to yourself to all the flock. Now listen to this. In which who? The Holy Ghost. You've been selected to be overseers of God's flock. You were not. You thought it was your own goodness and your own good looks and your own intellect and your own speech ability. You thought it was because people should follow you because of who you are. You're thinking that yourself is something. What you need to do is make sure you know that you're nothing without God. The Holy Ghost has made you overseers. And why? What did he do? Why did he make you overseers? To care for the church of God. That's his charge. His charge, if he's not doing that, he's not fulfilling his charge. Which he obtained, you've been purchased by God, not by your pastor.
Right.
But he's to care for you. It's important that you understand what makes a good pastor. And then he says, I know after my departure, fierce wolves will come in. There's wolves outside that door. Somebody's trying to put the devil's trying to pull you away from the church. He's trying to pull you away from your pastor. You sit around here saying, well, I want to go to a church where they have some good singing.
Go ahead.
I want to go to a church where they look good and they look prosperous. But God said this is where you need to be because this is your flock. And you have a shepherd. You go somewhere else, they may cut your skin, your fleece, and sell it. You walk around shivering whether it's cold or hot. They only shear sheep one time a year in the warm weather. A hireling will cut your wool off anytime he can sell it. He may even say, I got a nice fat sheep here. Let me sell this one because I need something in my pocket. He will make merchandise out of you. How many? You see him all day long. I won't call his name, Creflo Dollar. Anyway, I need an airplane. Why do you need an airplane? What made you so important that you need to prey upon poor people? You already living high above your people. You're not smelling like a sheep. You're wearing the best cologne. They're wearing high karate. Stetson, some of you know that stuff. They're not wearing Burberry. They going to Walmart getting their cologne. You don't smell like them. You're wearing tailor-made $1,000 suits, and they're getting theirs from Goodwill. But you telling them you need a jet. Something wrong with that picture. And people are chasing after that. Our pastor got a jet. You paying for the gas and the pilot and the food on it, and he riding in Concord, and you catching Sam trains. You catching BART. You catching bus. You ain't even got enough money for Uber. You need to understand what it means, how important it is to have a pastor. Now, I'm not praising my God, Brother Charles River. I'm just telling you what the word says. You evaluate him based on the word. I trust that you know that he meets these conditions.
Amen.
I know he does.
Amen.
I admire him. I look up to him. I love him. I love what he does with his family. I love what he does with his church. He preaches just as hard as if there was 1,500 people in here.
Amen.
You can't stop him from preaching.
No, Jesus.
He'll preach at you at the offering. He's going to preach. He's going to give you some word.
Amen.
That's a pastor.
Yes, he is.
He's concerned. You can't tell me that he don't love you. Because he shows it.
That's right.
He invests his resources, personal resources. His family is right here. He invested his family, and they're investing back into this church.
Yeah.
Sister Rivers sings, she plays, she prays, she cooks, and poor Destiny and Promise, they do everything. Yeah. They give the welcome, they sing, they dance, they give you a hot dog at the end of the service. Investing in you.
Amen.
They're investing in you as a family.
That's right.
And they set a good example. There ain't no scandal attached to this man.
That's right.
A true shepherd is not preying on the sheep and not finding what little pretty sheep he can get.
That's right.
He ain't looking at that. He's looking at your soul. Shepherd after God's own heart.
Thank you, Jesus.
The same characteristic that God has exhibited is the same one that pastor is supposed to have.
Amen. Amen.
You better recognize what you have here today.
Amen.
I'm so glad that Jesus is the good shepherd.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
I'm so glad that Jesus is the good shepherd.
Yes.
I'm so glad that he showed us what a shepherd looks like. I'm so glad that Jesus came looking for me. Because one day I was lost out there in the city.
Yes.
One day I was gone. One day I didn't have any direction.
Yeah.
And he came looking for me. Once I was that broken down sheep. I had mental health issues.
Yeah.
Not really. But I had some issues.
Uh-huh.
I had some bad behavior. I had some bad ideas. I was going the wrong direction, but Jesus came looking for me. You ought to be shouting out because he also came looking for you. You were here because he came looking for you.
Yes,
he is a shepherd that will not leave you by yourself.
Yes.
He is a shepherd that wants to protect you and uplift you. He is a shepherd that wants to heal you. He want to take all the bugs out your skin.
Yes.
He want to mend your broken heart.
Yes.
He want to fix your broken leg.
Yes.
He want to touch you where you need to be touched at. He is a good shepherd.
Yes.
And he came looking for me.
Yes, yes.
I came to Jesus.
Yes,
sir. That's all.
Yes.
Yes. That's right.
When he found that sheep didn't have to get dressed up in a suit.
Yeah.
He found that sheep looking just like it was, that little dirty pig.
Yeah.
There was fleas all over him. He still put them around his collar.
Amen.
He had to probably get deliced.
Yes.
Because that sheep had lice and all kinds of bugs on him.
Mm-hmm.
See, we as pastors don't want to touch those
that
are contaminated. Oh, I can't touch them.
Lord help.
You know, let's pray for you right here. Just right there.
Yeah.
Lord help.
But I came to Jesus just as I was.
Yes, yes.
I was weary, wounded, and sad.
Yes.
I found in him
Hallelujah.
A resting place.
Yes.
And I thank God that he has made me glad.
Yes.
I love the Lord.
Yes.
He heard my cry.
Yes.
And he pitied every groan.
Yes.
Long as I live.
And trouble
ride, I will hasten to his throne.
Yes.
It's good to know Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
It's good to know Jesus.
Yes.
It's good to know Jesus.
Yes.
He's a lily of the valley.
Yes.
He's a bright and morning star.
Yes.
He's a sweet rose of shit.
Go ahead.
He is my balm in Gilead.
Yes.
He's my provider. He's my healer.
Yes.
He's my banner. He's the Lord of hosts. He walks before me.
Yes.
The Lord
is
my shepherd. I shall not want. He leads me beside the still waters.
Yes.
He restores my soul.
Yes.
It's good to know Jesus.
Yes.
Yes.
It's good to know Jesus.
Yes.
It's good to know the Lord.
Yes.
It's good to know him.
Huh.
It's good to know the Lord. Do you know him today?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that you have a shepherd?
Yes.
That set the standard for every other shepherd.
Yes.
If I don't follow the standard of Jesus Christ, I'm no good to you.
Yes.
Yeah.
A shepherd, a pastor,
yes, Lord,
with the heart of God.
Yeah.
A pastor, a shepherd with the right heart and the right motive.
Yes.
We thank God that you, Starlight, you're blessed beyond measure.
Yes.
Because you have a pastor. Don't look at your numbers. Don't look at the size of the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Just start getting busy and working for the
That's
Lord.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.